Would you join me in prayer?
Lord, we come to you knowing that you are our one true God and that you alone can save. And we know that marriage is sovereignly and divinely appointed by you. And God, we pray not just for the day, but we pray for the length of this marriage. We pray for how they will be united for your glory and for your name. And we pray this through the power of Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. We are here today to celebrate the commitment between Joel and Allie and what they're making to each other and before God. Joel and Allie, you both stand here before families who have seen you grow from babies into bride and groom. Your parents have invested great amounts of time, love, and wisdom into your lives. And they stand with you today as you officially move into the next phase of your life together. So it's time to get started. And I want to begin by asking, Joel, will you have Allie to be your wife and live together with her in holy marriage? Do you make a vow before God in the presence of these witnesses that you will love her, comfort her, honor her, respect her, and keep her? Will you forsake all others and be faithful to her as long as you both shall live? And Allie, will you have Joel to be your husband, to live together with him in holy marriage? Do you make a vow before God in the presence of these witnesses that you will love him, comfort him, honor him, respect him, and keep him? Will you forsake all others and be faithful to him as long as you both shall live? With that in mind, I would ask, who gives this bride to be married to Joel? When Joel and Allie called me a few months back and asked me to be a part of the wedding, I could sense this was something special. During our first few minutes together, I could tell these two people had captured each other's hearts. I could tell one because this good old Southern boy drove halfway across the country for Allie. And then Allie moved back home. She was so homesick, only to find out she was homesick for this guy named Joel. And when you see this excitement between two people, it's truly a blessing to everyone around. And when God has given this man and this woman to each other, it's a blessing to all of us. So as their friends and their family, old roommates, new family, maybe co-workers, or maybe this your baby who's all grown up, you are all here because you hold a special place in their hearts. You all came here today to celebrate and witness them commit their lives to one another and covenant before God. But I also want you to see your particular role here. It's much more important than that of a spectator. While Joel and Allie make this marriage covenant before God, you are here not only as witnesses, but also as the people they'll be accountable to for the rest of their lives. Your invitation to this wedding was also an invitation to their marriage. They need you to do more than cheer them on as they begin their lives together. They need you to encourage them as they complete their lives together. See, we have all been conditioned to believe that a wedding is a public event, and a marriage is a semi-private event, and that marriage problems are completely off limits to anyone but the couple themselves. But I want to challenge your thinking on that today and remind you that as witnesses to their vows, you must encourage them to uphold these vows. As anyone who has been married more than a week knows, there will be difficult days, and there will be days when they're tempted to throw their hands up. Because you see, true love is not shown by the intensity of the beginning, but by the endurance to the end. In the book of Ephesians, it says that marriage is a great mystery. And when you take two very different people who are sinners by nature and put them under one roof, you could have a recipe for disaster. But that's not the mystery in Ephesians is talking about. The mystery is that marriage is designed to represent something much bigger than something, and it's something much greater. It is designed to be the real-life picture of the message of the gospel of Jesus. So as Joel and Allie stand here today, they represent the relationship between Jesus Christ and his church, and the relationship that Christ desires with each of us. It is basically impossible for two to uphold their vows under their own strength. You see, they can only say I do to each other because Jesus first said I do to them. So today, we join with Joel and Allie in realizing the full story behind the mystery of marriage. That Jesus lived a life we couldn't live and died a death we should have died. And that this marriage points beyond them to the gospel. The good news that Jesus extends forgiveness and hope today for everyone who will receive. Today is not just about the vows of two people, but about the power of a relationship with Jesus, who will never, ever break his vows. And specifically, to Joel and Allie and their marriage covenant. Now, Joel and Allie, today you are entering into a marriage covenant, and you will make vows and promises that will take you a lifetime to fulfill. Marriage is not a contract whereby you provide each other with happiness and fulfillment, but it's a covenant, a never stopping, never giving up, unbreakable, always and forever love. And this covenant is displayed in marriage, and it requires three things from each of you. First, your love must be sacrificial. Joel, you must love Allie like Christ loved the church, ready and willing to give her life up for you. Daily, you must place her needs above your own. And Allie, God has given you the responsibility of submitting to Joel's loving leadership. As we discussed, submission does not mean less than him. It means coming alongside. So what this means is that you both must die to your own preferences and put one another above each other. Second, your love must be passionate. There's nothing more beautiful than a bride on her wedding day. And Allie, that's true of you today. Just as you both have taken hours and days and weeks and months to prepare for this day, if you're going to have that passion that lasts a lifetime, it's going to take consistent preparation on the physical, emotional, and spiritual level. Every single day, you're going to have to choose to love one another. See, we live in a society that says preparation for the wedding is the most important, but not the marriage. So my prayer is that you two wake up each and every morning passionate about each other, that you're just obsessed with each other, that you're always newlyweds, and that you guard your hearts and minds against anyone who's not this boss. So Joel, what that means for you is Allie is now your standard of beauty. If she's skinny, you like skinny women. If she puts on some pounds, you like your women with some meat. Allie, you're not just marrying Joel because he's your kind of guy, but he's now your kind of guy because you're married to him. And third, your love must be consistent. What this means is that marriage is an act of love that's not based on a feeling, but on a choice. You don't wait to have a feeling before you take care of your body. See, love is not a gut feeling. It's a choice. It's not an emotion. It's a choice. We know that love is a verb, and a verb is played out in each of you by being patient with one another, kind, not envying, not being boastful, proud, or rude, or self-seeking. Your love towards one another should not easily be angered, and it should keep no record of wrongs. Your love should always protect and trust, always hope and persevere. If you choose to love like that by the power of the Holy Spirit, your love will never fail. Love as a feeling is fleeting, but as a choice, it's consistent. So I pray that your love for one another is sacrificial, it's passionate, and consistent until the end of your days. Now, as a sign of their love, we will now seal this covenant with the giving and exchanging of rings. Now, this ring is a circle, never starting, never ending. This is a symbol of the pledge you're making to one another, that love is endless. I pray that these rings will remind you of the love you have for one another. More than that, I pray these rings will be a testimony of your faithfulness to the covenant you are making today. Now, Joel, I want you to look at Allie's hands. Because these hands are the hands that will love you and hold you after a long day. They will comfort you during your weakest moments. These are the hands that will hold your children and wipe the tears from their eyes. It will hold you when you pray together. These hands are the hands that will love you when you grow old. They are a gift from God. As you prepare to enter into this marriage covenant, hear these words of wisdom and instructions from Ephesians 5. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Let each husband love his wife as himself. Now, Joel, please place this hand, place this ring on her hand, and repeat after me. I, Joel, take you, Allie, to be my wife. This ring I joyfully give to you as a lifelong symbol of my commitment to you, my wife and my best friend. I do this in the name of our Savior and precious friend, Jesus Christ. Now, Allie, I want you to look at Joel's hands. These are the hands that will work for you. These are the hands that will protect you. These are the hands that will comfort you during your darkest troubles and will lift you up when you are down. These are the hands that will play with your children and that will lead you and your children in the application of God's word. These are the hands that will be with you as you grow old, and they are a gift from God. Allie, as you prepare to enter into this marriage covenant, hear these words of wisdom from Proverbs. An excellent wife who can find, she is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts her in her and will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. So, Allie, will you place this ring on Joel's hand and repeat after me? I, Allie, take you, Joel, to be my husband. This ring I joyfully give to you as a lifelong symbol of my commitment to you, my husband and my best friend. I do this in the name of our Savior and precious friend, Jesus Christ. Now at this time, Joel and Allie are going to spend a few moments praying together and with their family. This is a time where we see these two families coming together as one unified by Jesus. As we have seen, this marriage is centered on their relationship with Jesus and their love for each other. So I would like to ask the father and mother of the bride and groom to come and join Joel and Allie to pray. That you bring people together, God, to fulfill a desire. we also know that you have given us marriage as just a covenant picture of how you have loved us and how you love us. So I pray that Joel and Allie will center their relationship on you and live their lives just devoted to each other, fully and completely centered around you. And we pray this through the power of Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Joel and Allie, today marks a new era in your life. You no longer walk as individuals, but you walk as one together. No longer two, but one. From this day forward, together. You will trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. And together, you are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. Having pledged your love to one another by the power vested in me, a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Joel, you may kiss your bride. So ladies and gentlemen, I now present to you Mr. and Mrs. Joel Adcock.
Baby daughter today, glad I gave her to a good young man. He's an exceptionally good guy, and I'm sure people that know him know that. Allie figured that out when she decided to marry him. So I do want to thank everybody for coming out. I think it's fantastic, kind of an emotional day, but in a good way. It's the start of a whole new chapter. My family and Joel's family. I'm going to pass this on to my dad. He's going to say the blessing before you.
Thank you, sir. We want to first of all thank everybody for waiting. We have because it's been quite late, but all the good things come to them. I will say one thing: you don't never figure out how God's going to do things because you just can't. In a galaxy far, far away, actually it was Illinois, a little blonde-headed girl used to wait on me at the coffee shop, that's Alan's wife, and I had no idea that they would become husband and wife, and more so that they would produce a perfect little blonde girl that we are so proud of. And so I can't, as Grandpa, I can say that Grandma and I extremely proud of you two, and wow, our family just got a lot bigger all of a sudden. So if you bow your heads for a second. Lord, we do thank you for the privilege of marriage. You once said that it's not good for a man to live alone, and you believe that. So thank you, Lord, for our mates. Thank you for our families. We know that, God, you're a family man. So give us strength to back them up, that when they need us, the family is there for them, not against them, and that as two families coming together, that will be our job. Now, bless this food, Lord, to the nourishment of our bodies, and may we leave here happy people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please. Oh, that was intentional. fake it on that one. There we go. Hey guys, on three. Y'all ready? One, two, three.
You are awful.